This is the initial part of the downtown area that is under construction now as part of phase one. It's called Founders Square, and all around Founders Square is kind of the basics of the initial downtown, so that the first residents, from the time they move in, there'll be these local amenities for them to come down and have gathering places and, you know, have farmers market on the weekends or, you know, concerts in our band shell there. So right now the restaurant is almost complete, as is this. It's called Woodley Hall. And here is where we're going to have a discovery center where people can come and learn about the different aspects of the community. The upstairs is actually going to be the offices for Kitson and Partners and Babcock Ranch. And then on this end is what we have, an outdoor outfitters store, so that people can come and rent bikes or canoes or, you know, use those to explore the community from the very beginning. Because it isn't just a neighborhood, it's not a gated community, it's a town, and it's open to anyone, so we want to have those kind of things that people can come in and enjoy from the very beginning. Over here, this will begin fairly soon, and it's just called a market cafe at the bottom, and that'll have a coffee shop, an ice cream shop, and just kind of your basic daily goods and needs that will be very convenient. And then the upstairs is a hatchery, which is a collaborative workspace where we're envisioning people can use that as, you know, an office to come and work in a collaborative way for either second careers or young entrepreneurs, just to really engage that innovation in the second floor there. And then across here, the school is actually already well under construction. It'll be opening in August, K through 8 charter school, public charter school. Wow. So, and we're actually getting ready to do the lottery for the applicants, and we're already at capacity.
I bet.
People coming from both counties. And then shortly thereafter, the construction will begin. This is a health and wellness center. It's really comprehensive. It's not just like a typical gym, but it also have, you know, doctor's offices and, you know, kind of the basic services like that, and rehab center. Those sort of things will all be worked in as part of the community. I mean.
Okay.
So one of the things that happened early on is they came in and they had to clear out all the invasives. The tall pines that you see are ones that were already here. What you're seeing here, we have landscaping requirements throughout the community. It's 75% has to be native landscaping. And then it's even on the individual lots, 30% in turf, only 30%. The turf you're seeing out here was actually grown on our sod farm.
The story of Babcock Ranch is fascinating, and it's kind of a long story. So I'm just going to, at this point, tell you that Babcock Ranch, the thousands and thousands of acres that make up Babcock Ranch, were to all intents and purposes a working ranch, farm, wildlife refuge, and family retreat. I mean, it was everything in one, and everything that was done on it was done responsibly. There was only rotational grazing. There was only rotational farming. If something had been put into watermelons one year, it wouldn't be put into watermelons for a while. It would be allowed to rest. They did sod farming, and it was done with underground water that was gray water rather than groundwater. And so the whole story of the original Babcock Ranch is one of conservation, responsible conservation. And yet they did have money-making ventures that allowed them to run Babcock Ranch and protect it with the funds that came in from those ventures. Now, the premise of the town that is being created is that they will carry that on. The sewer, all the water that's used in the town for anything but potable water is gray water. They have solar panels that will power the homes. They are changing the way that the canals in the area work so that instead of taking water off the surface of the land, instead it allows it to sink into the land and recreate swamp areas for wildlife. And so in the process of creating this town that could be a bad thing, what they're really trying to do is bring an economic surge to it so that those who care about the land will protect it by bringing income into it. And there are areas that are for housing, but then there are strictly much larger areas that will still continue to be used as wildlife refuge, and then sprinkling spots where there will still be grazing, where there will still be agriculture. For instance, some really interesting things are that the sod that goes in, only 30% of any landscaping is allowed to be sod, but the sod that is going to be there is actually harvested from Babcock Ranch, which I think the more I listened to what it was they were doing to try and make this model work, the more I was really impressed with how they didn't really forget anything that needed to be taken care of.
You'll notice in Florida, cinder block is pretty much standard. Everyone builds with cinder block. These are actually built with SIPS panel, new panel homes, and they're manufactured up in Inglewood, not far from here. And it's a system where it's got hardy board on either side and styrofoam in the end, so they use 50% less energy than standard construction for cooling. So it can change, the temperature could change 20 degrees outside and it would only change 2 degrees inside. So definitely energy efficiency is a big part of it. And part of that, you know, throughout the community is we've got that 75 megawatt solar field. And, you know, yes, it goes on the grid. It's all generated right here on Babcock Ranch on land that we donated. It goes to a substation, and when the sun's shining, comes in here, and what does, you know, what we aren't using goes on the grid. Well, at night we're getting, you know, pulling power off the grid.
Right.
Until they solve the whole challenge of energy, you know, storage of solar power.
Right.
Which is kind of the holy grail. Through energy efficiency and the amount we're generating, we will always be using less than we're producing.
So later on, if there were people who wanted to come in and do things a little differently, something like a dome or some other stranger kind of non-traditional home, is it possible for people to do something like that?
Everything that's built here will have to go through the architectural review committee. So
if somebody came in and they could convince someone to let them do it as a trial, do you think they would? There's a possibility it would go through?
I don't know because I'm not part of that. So, and again, as the community grows and it becomes, instead of, you know, like say the independent special district, you start to have more and more elected representation, it'll be like any other government entity. People who want to do those kind of things would have to go through their government entity and try and get approval for it. So,
oh, interesting.
It's not any different than other places in that respect.
And are they trying to keep it more upscale, or are some of the trends from around the country where you can have a backyard chicken, or if you get permission from your neighbors, you can do a backyard goat? Is anything like that going to be?
I think that's all to be determined as we get, like,
still
say,
in the future,
as we have community representation. So right now, that wouldn't be appropriate in this neighborhood because no one has a big enough yard to have that. So,
right.
But as we, and again, it's part of the principles of sustainability is we have the denser here, and then as we get out toward the edge and we get out toward the borders with the preserve, there will be the larger lot opportunities out there. So that might be something that they would be looking at out there where it would be more permanent. Part of the, like I say, that's really part of the stormwater control.
Here is another unique aspect of the way that Babcock Ranch is thinking about subdivisions. The streets are sloped towards not a drainage system, but a water garden system. They are trying to encourage wildlife and natural swamp, and I'm going to show you the curb, that it slopes down towards that infiltration of the water and filtration of the water rather than creating runoff systems that will just go downstream.
And you said, what starts in August? You told me something was going to be...
The school.
The school will be up and going.
It'll be up and going in August.
Yeah.
I say we've already had full enrollment, so...
Just from local kids, since nobody's living here yet.
Right. Pretty much as soon as this one's done and going, they'll already be starting construction on the full-size school, so... And I think we're, you know, it's K through 8. The enrollment we've got right now, it looks like K through 6.
Mm-hmm.
But we also have the ability and the space to add some portables. So as we start having people move in, we can expand the capacity.
Wow.
To make sure that we are able to let people
that actually
live here as well.
Okay, so the roofs of all the buildings are going to have solar.
Well, the ones that you see that are southern facing, like, uh-huh, with that angle, those are built specifically to be solar. For the solar. So we'll be expanding our production ability.
So not just the one big field of
right,
solar panels.
But it's huge. Yeah, I mean, that's the major, but we still have the ability to expand. And FPL is going to be putting solar trees in our park areas, too.
Wow.
And they're kind of have you seen a solar tree?
I have. They're kind of bizarre.
They're kind of like art and functional, and they're charging stations.
Right.
Yeah, so when we did the groundbreaking for the school, I had this little project I created for the kids where I had them making their own little solar trees. They had a little solar panel and some fans to turn on, and it was cool.
Why not?
Because, we want those kind of things that people really interact with, not just be powered by the energy and it's invisible, but it's, a very visible part of the community and they're interacting with it to have a better appreciation that,
And isn't that part of the hatchery idea, why you have the hatchery, is because you're kind of trying to spawn new ideas. I mean, you're doing this to do the best of what's available with what you have now, but the hatchery is meant to be as like a, can we take it further?
The hatchery is, first of all, just to kind of launching that whole entrepreneurial spirit. So you have a place where people that are coming in and starting businesses, or maybe they're doing second career and they don't want to work from home all the time. It's a place where they can kind of come together and bounce things off of each other. But the idea really with the whole community, with the technology that we've got throughout the whole community is, we think it should be a living learning laboratory. It should attract the kind of businesses that are trying to produce these things and trying to come up with these solutions, like battery storage.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what a great place for them to come and locate their business at Babcock Ranch, where they're surrounded by people that have kind of that, those early adopter mentality, right? And they can put it into practice and see how it works and work out the kinks, and then, have a place to
experiment.
A proving ground. And they say,
Okay,
it works, and now we're going to go out and sell it to the world, right?
Okay, so the middle of March is going to be the big extravaganza.
It's the Founders Fest.
Founders Fest.
For the first annual. And so we're going to have farmers market and concerts on the lawn here. The restaurant will be open. The Discovery Center will be open. And then, in the community parks, we'll probably be having the three-legged races down there. We're going to have a 5K race. And so, actually, our next meeting to planning is this afternoon, so I'll know more then.
So do they stock the lake, or is it naturally stocked? Natural?
It would traditionally has been naturally stocked. I think they'll be augmenting that some as they move forward.
Here we're getting to go look at the fringes of the property. Again, there's just, I think it's 10%, if I remember correctly, of the actual refuge will go into homes. And those are to stay in areas that had been grazed. So it's not pristine wilderness that the homes are going into. Now, out here on the fringes is where the grazing happens and where the watermelon happens, where the eco tours go on, and also where the solar panels are, the gray water treatment facility. And so that's what we're about to go look at. It's still beautiful, beautiful country, and I'm excited to see if this turns out as well as their planning would seem to point to it turning out.
A lot of sense to where we put the borders and what we decided to keep and what we sold to the state.
Try to make it be a natural break rather than
we're trying to take the most environmentally sensitive lands and putting that into preserve, right?
Uh-huh.
We're taking the pieces that were cleared out.
They've done a lot of work in here to keep it nice and open, haven't they?
Well, like I said, that's the work that I said, that money that is needed is the controlled burns that are done on a regular basis. And you can see by the density of the pines that there's been timbering done in here, but this is an example of the selective harvest where they come in and they take out and then they leave the seed trees.
Does that make you a little nervous? Do they have any accountability to the ranch anymore to be able to say, well, you're not doing it right?
Oh, well, they have to count over to the citizens of Florida, so. This is an area that's being cycled back. You can tell it was watermelon by the ditches around it.
Uh-huh. And that's drained just a little bit of the water off?
Yeah. And then this is just various stuff that was like from when they had the hunting leases and stuff all over the property. You know, there was just equipment here and there, and they just kind of pulled it all together until they could figure out ownership and get it out of here.
He's mad? What are you doing here?
Oh yeah, so the... I'll through this area. But we're back to having Curry Lake that actually has water in it all year long. So.
This is the part of the property where there used to be one particular draining ditch. And as you can see, they have blocked it off so that instead of carrying water away, it now holds water in place. And they are able to repopulate areas with wildlife because the landscape changes as it resaturates. Different plants come in, different animals come in, and that's the point of holding the water on the property now. And even though it will still help with flooding because they're changing the way that they're doing earthworks so that they have more space to hold water rather than just having narrow ditches that hold water. And so it's really fun to see the difference between the one side of the drainage ditch and the side of the drainage ditch that they're now holding water into the landscape and the difference in the riparian area and the greenery.
So this is this year's watermelon. They just keep rotating them around.
Time, so rock mining, sod farming, watermelons, cattle.
Cattle.
Mm-hmm. Is that all of them?
I think we still had some hunting leases on the part of the land that was ours, so we had that as well. So this the water and wastewater, and then this is the Hercules substation, though, so the FPL solar plant. This is where it feeds down to here from the solar field, and then from here comes to the community or goes to the grid. This is the area where we have the sod farms. When we get, there's an area up here that we'll probably put in that larger scale community farming opportunities for people that live in the town and want to have their plot of land out there to do some more larger scale farming.
Mm-hmm.
And this is also the entrance to the ecotour. So sod over here. Growing sod for our community. And it's cool because the sod actually, the irrigation for the sod is underground. It's the percolating water underneath the surface. So you have a lot less loss. And the fields, the 460 acres where the solar plant was put in, was also sod farm, but it was one the one area where they had aerial irrigation as opposed to the underground. So we put it in the spot where Mariana, well, let's give up the part that's, you know, using more water than the others.
It looks pretty impressive.
It goes as far as you can see, and it makes a little turn, and then it goes as far as you can see again. So where you see the dirt up on this end, where they had parking when they had all the construction, they're putting in pollination gardens, so they're doing a lot of butterfly plants and those kind of plantings, just that will be, you know, again, good for the farming in the area to kind of add a little pollination area for bees and butterflies.
And they were called Wonderful Bees?
Wonderful Bees is the name of the company.
Wonderful Bees, because we saw it just across the road and I didn't get the footage, so hopefully as we drive back, they're still playing with the bees so I can catch them.
Oh yeah, we can definitely go back there. It's like the Park Service employees have certainly shown themselves to be heroes and